Okay, I think we can start. And it is with great pleasure that I welcome Professor Chantal Mouffe to our university. Chantal, apart from being one of the two founding figures of the Essex School of Discourse Analysis, has also contributed very challenging interpretations of populism, and that's why we are very glad to have her here in this workshop. Chantal is professor of political theory at the University of Westminster. I will not provide any other biographical reference. I'm sure you're all familiar with her work. We are very happy that she's with us today. And Chantal, the floor is yours.
Well, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here in Thessaloniki and to take part in this workshop. I'm going to approach this question from the point of view of the work I've been doing recently. So it's not really strictly a political science approach, it's also political theory and some kind of political engagement also with the current situation. So it's a kind of sui generis presentation. When we envisage the present state of democracy, one of the assertions that we often come across is that our condition is one of post-democracy. The meaning conveyed by this notion of post-democracy is that modern democracies, while maintaining the facade of formal democratic principle, are increasingly controlled by privileged elites. The implementation of neoliberal policies has led to the colonization of the state by corporate interests, and crucial political decisions are now taken outside the traditional democratic channels. The loss of legitimacy of democratic institutions manifests itself in a growing phenomenon of depoliticization. Well, not always the case, and of course, you are going to see that many of the things I'm going to say are pertinent for most of European countries, but not so much for Greece in some cases. In some cases, of course, it's even worse in Greece, but in other cases, the situation politically, I think, looks a little bit more interesting and hopeful. I agree with many aspects of the analysis of the people who criticize our societies for being post-democratic. But I think that when we envisage the reason for this phenomenon of post-democracy and also envisage how this tendency could be reversed, it is important, I think, to stress the role that parties of the left have played in this process of disaffection with democratic politics. In a book called On the Political, I have examined the reason for what I call the post-political perspective, which has become dominant in liberal democratic societies. I have argued that it is linked to the move toward the center, which in the last decade has been the strategy of most social democratic parties in Europe, a strategy which, under the motto of the Third Way, was first elaborated for New Labour in Britain by Anthony Giddens. According to such an approach, Western societies have entered what is called a second stage of modernity, one of reflexive modernization, where the adversarial model of politics, which was characteristic of the first stage of simple modernization, has become obsolete. Giddens claimed that it is not necessary to think beyond left and right. That's, in fact, the title of one of his books. And he envisaged a new type of politics of the radical center, which transcend the old-fashioned left-right divide. Such a view was later adopted by other socialist and social democratic parties, which began to present themselves as center-left, clearly indicating that they were rejecting their former anti-capitalist elements. Under the pretense of modernizing the social democratic project so as to adapt it to a globalized world, center-left parties, in fact, capitulated to neoliberalism. convinced that there was no alternative anymore to the current form of globalized financial capitalism, they accepting the framework that was, you know, established by neoliberal hegemony. Having abandoned any attempt to challenge the existing relation of power, they now limit themselves to propose ways to humanize the neoliberal globalization. This is why I think their policies are very hard to distinguish from those of the center-right party. So what I call post-political is a situation in which, you know, there is fundamentally no significant difference between center-right and center-left policies. So no possibility for, you know, citizens to make a real choice. And it is my contention that this consensus at the center has very negative consequences for democratic politics. Indeed, it is the absence of a real choice between clearly distinguished this alternative which explains the current lack of interest for politics, which has produced a drastic fall in participation in elections. Another consequence of the convergence between center-right and center-left parties is that in several countries, such a situation has favored the emergence of right-wing populist parties, whose success is due to the fact that they appear as being the only ones that offer an alternative to the existing order. And in fact, on the political, I examined some of the cases and show that basically in many European countries where, you know, the right-wing populism was making important inroads, it was always linked to this lack of fundamental difference between center-right and center-left parties. And of course, the situation, the book was published in 2005, and the thing, in fact, have really not changed. It's getting worse since then. It seems to me that in the discussion about post-democracy, the role played by this post-political situation is not sufficiently taken into account. It is, of course, necessary to grasp the transformation of the capitalist system, which have provided the economic condition for the success of neoliberal globalization. And that's what, you know, the post-democracy insists on. But that does not automatically explain the reason for the disappearance of a vibrant democratic debate about the different ways in which social relations and public institutions can be organized. And this is where the responsibility of the parties of the left need to be recognized. By failing to acknowledge that politics is intrinsically partisan and that democratic politics requires what they've called an agonistic debate among conflicting projects and a real choice between the different alternatives, the consensual politics of the third way has contributed to the depoliticization which is at the core of our post-democratic condition. When citizens feel that they cannot have a say in the fundamental decision which concern their common affair, and that political questions are dealt with by experts, which are considered, you know, because those decisions are considered of being of the technical nature, then democratic institutions are emptied of their substance and their legitimacy is threatened. Elections are reduced to providing a rubber stamp for measures which are imposed by a variety of actors whose interests are not publicly accountable, and the democratic process loses its raison d'être. To be sure, our society still claims to be democratic, but what is the meaning of democracy in our post-political times? Scrutinizing the nature of liberal democracy in a book, The Democratic Paradox, I brought to the fore the tension existing between its two ethico-political principles, liberty and equality. Liberal democracy, I've argued, should be understood as the articulation between two different traditions, the liberal tradition of the rule of law, individual rights, and the democratic tradition of popular sovereignty. Canadian political theorist C.B. McPherson has shown in a very nice little book called The Life and Times of Liberal Democracy, how through this articulation between liberalism and democracy, which was established during the 19th century, liberalism was democratized and democracy liberalized. However, there was always a tension between the exigencies of liberty and those of equality, a tension which has provided the dynamic of the confrontation between left and right until now. The history of democratic politics can be visualized in terms of the struggle for the predominance of one of those principles over the other. In some period, the liberal aspect was dominant, in other, it was the democratic one. But the contestation remained open. What has happened under the current hegemony of neoliberalism is that the liberal component has become so dominant, and even in a very restricted interpretation of liberalism, a neoliberal interpretation, that the democratic one has been almost disappeared. Democracy is now understood simply in terms of the rule of law and defense of human rights, and the idea of popular sovereignty has been relinquished as being obsolete. Those who resist the rule of elites and insist that one need to give a voice to the people and to make room for their demand are dismissed as being populist. In my view, this displacement of the democratic tradition by the liberal one is one of the main features of our post-democratic condition. And it is clearly visible in the abandon by center-left parties of the struggle for equality. Their main slogans are now about choice, fairness, equity, and inclusion, but they take pains to avoid speaking of equality that they consider as being so tainted by the egalitarianism of the socialist ideals that they have to be repudiated. Deprived of the vocabulary that constituted the backbone of its vision of society, it is therefore not surprising that the left is incapable of envisaging an alternative to neoliberal globalization and to really, you know, fight against the phenomenon of privatization. Without abandoning the consensus of the center, politics, which is one of the cause of the progressive irrelevance of democratic institutions, there is no hope of escaping the post-democratic trend. It is necessary to fight against the blurring of the line between left and right and to put forward a clearly defined left project. Such a blurring between left and right, patchy-third way theorists, far from constituting, as they pretend, a progress, a move toward a supposedly more mature democracy, is in fact what could lead to its demise. It is urgent to revive the democratic process, and this can only be done by the parties of the left launching a counter-hegemonic offensive against the neoliberal attempt to destroy the central institution of the welfare state and to privatize the whole of social life, subjecting it to the rule of the market. So to just resume my argument so far, my diagnostic is that we are witnessing a crisis of representation as a consequence of the consensus at the center that has come to dominate politics in most liberal democratic societies. This consensus, which is the result of the unchallenged hegemony of neoliberalism, deprives democratic citizens of an agonistic debate where they can make their voice heard and choose between real alternatives. So this is what I think what it means post-political, post-democratic condition. Well, till recently, the rejection of this consensus at the center had come principally from right-wing populist parties, and it has been articulated in xenophobic language. Fortunately, we have begun to witness a different kind of critique thanks to the development of a variety of protest movements, like, for instance, the Indignados or Occupy. With those recent protests, we are seeing the emergence of other ways, certainly much more estimable, of reacting against the democratic deficit that characterizes our post-democratic societies and to express the dissatisfaction with the current neoliberal order. If so many people, not only among the youth, but across the whole population, have been, you know, taking part in protest, it's because they have lost faith in traditional parties and they feel that their voice cannot be heard through traditional political channels. As one of the motto of the protester claims, we have a voice, we have a vote, but we don't have a voice. As we can vote, yet, but since, you know, there is no difference between the parties, we don't really have a voice. And I think that's really what is characteristic of this post-political situation. It must be noted that when it comes to the interpretation of the recent protest movement, there exist divergent views. To be sure, there is a broad agreement among political commentators on one aspect. The recent protests are not mere reaction to the current austerity measure. They reveal a more profound political malaise vis-à-vis democratic institutions, whose crisis they bring to the fore. But opinions diverge about what the protesters really want. Many theorists, influenced by the exodus approach developed by Hart and Negri in their, you know, trilogy, Empire, Multitude, and Commonwealth, see in recent mobilization a manifestation of the power of the multitude, constructing new form of social relation outside traditional political institutions. They celebrate them as the realization of the common, you know, it's a really big buzzword at the moment, and present their encampment as the prefiguration of what they call absolute democracy. For them, those movements are characteristic of the new form of struggle of the precarious workers, which are typical of post-Fordism, and they argue that what, for instance, the Spanish indignados with their call for democracia realia, real democracy, you know, what those indignados advocate is, they say, a radically different understanding of democracy, beyond representation, a democracy in actu, a presentist democracy. Presentist democracy is, in their view, the opposite of representative democracy. It is a matter of collective political practice without any claim to government. They are against any form of representation, and they express a total rejection of liberal democracy. So this is the interpretation which, you know, is quite influential among those movements and be clearly influenced by the strategy of exodus of Hart and Negri and some other post-operaists like, for instance, Paolo Virno. Well, I would like to propose a different interpretation of those protest movements. In my view, under Sutter's refusal of the post-political order, current protests can be read as a call for a radicalization of liberal democratic institutions, not for their rejection. What they exact are better, more inclusive forms of representation. To satisfy their demand for voice, existing representative institutions have to be transformed, a new one established, so as to create the condition for an agonistic confrontation where the citizen will be offered real alternative. Such a confrontation requires not a strategy of withdrawal from existing institutions, but a strategy of engagement with those institutions in order to profoundly transform those institutions. So in agonistic, my most recent work, I've precisely contrasted the strategy of withdrawal from with institution, which is the one of exodus, and the strategy of engagement with institution to transform them radically, which is the strategy of, you know, war of position, the Gramscian counter-hegemonic strategy that both Ernesto and Laclau and I, we advocate. So this, the interpretation that I want to make of those movements is that what they want is a strategy of radicalization of representative democracy. And it requires the emergence of a genuine left, a left able to offer an alternative to the social liberal consensus dominant in center-left parties. And I'm going to say in a moment more about, you know, what I understand by this genuine left. The recent citizen awakening, that's how I would want to call it, in Europe and in the USA is very encouraging, of course, because it breaks with the post-political consensus. A taboo has been broken and many voices are now being heard contesting the inequalities existing in our societies. It's very important that the theme of equality, for instance, in the Occupy has become, you know, again central. And as I said, the difference of, you know, the center-left, we had eliminated this element of equality. To effectively challenge neoliberalism. It is crucial, though, that all the energy that have erupted in those protests are not diverted towards wrong allies. I'm afraid that this is what could happen if representative institutions become the main target of the protest. There is no denying that representative institutions are in crisis in their current liberal democratic form. But I do not believe that the solution resides in the establishment of a non-representative democracy or that civil society struggles are the only vehicle for making democratic advances. Such views are, of course, very popular because they chime with the idea, which is fashionable among sectors of the left, that the multitude could auto-organize itself, avoiding taking power and avoiding becoming state. I find that to see such an anti-political approach among activists involved in the various movements of the outrage, I find that worrying, because it forecloses the possibility of designing an adequate strategy for their struggle. When representation is seen as the problem, the aim cannot be to engage with current institutions to make them more representative and more accountable, but it will become then to discard those institutions entirely. The objective of the movement will therefore be visualized in terms of an exodus from given form of democracy on the ground that attempting to transform existing institutions is vain and then that representative democracy is to be relinquished. Many among those who reject representation identify representative democracy with its current post-democratic form and with the actual working of the parliamentary system. They do not see that the problem concerns the way in which representative institutions function at the moment and the fact that so many voices are excluded from representation. What needs to be challenged is the lack of alternative offered to the citizen, not the very idea of representation. A pluralist democratic society cannot exist without representation. To begin with, as the anti-essentialist approach has made clear, identities are never already given, but always produced, constructed through identification. And this process of identification is a process of representation. It is through representation that collective political subjects are created, and they do not exist beforehand. Every assertion of a political identity is thereby interior, no exterior to the process of representation. So that's the first point. Secondly, in a democratic society where pluralism is not envisaged in the harmonious anti-political form, and where the ever-present possibility of antagonism is taken into account, representative institutions, by giving form to the division of society, play a crucial role in allowing for the institutionalization of this conflictual dimension. However, such a role can only be fulfilled through the availability of an agonistic confrontation. What constitutes the central problem with our current post-political model is the absence of such an agonistic confrontation. And this is not going to be remedied through horizontalist practices. This is not to say that the type of activism to which such terms refer do not have a role to play in an agonistic democracy. I'm convinced that the variety of civil society struggle and the multiple forms of activism are valuable, not only to raise the consciousness and to bring to the fore issues that are neglected, but also as providing a realm for the cultivation of different social relations. What I contend is that those practices, well, besides the fact that they always entail a dimension of representation, cannot provide a substitute for representative institutions, and that it is necessary to establish a synergy between those practices and other more institutional forms of struggle. If the protest movement refuses to establish alliance with traditional political channels deemed as intrinsically impervious to democratic transformation, their radical potential will be lost. Amazingly, some activists, you know, in those movements are still celebrating the horizontalism experience in Argentina in 2000, you know, the moment of the struggle of the Piqueteros, presenting them as the model to follow without acknowledging the limit of such a strategy. They do not seem to realize that the democratic advances that have taken place in Argentina as well as in other South American countries in the last 10 years have been made possible thanks to an articulation of struggle of the social movement and parliamentary struggle. Those are the experiences from which the European left can learn, and it is high time to stop romanticizing spontaneism and horizontalism. The call for democracy that is now being voiced in a variety of quarters can only produce lasting effect if the activists involved in those movements, instead of implementing a strategy of withdrawal from institutions, accept becoming part of a collective, progressive collective will, engage in a war of position to radicalize democratic institutions and to establish a new hegemony. So this is, you know, my interpretation of the protest movement and the way in which I think they could really become, if they are articulated, that they could be a real important element for change. I have argued earlier that in order to address the crisis of representative democracy and to foster an agonistic debate, what is needed is the formulation of a genuine left project, a left offering an alternative to our current post-democratic condition, which is due, as I've argued, to neoliberal hegemony. I would like to explain now why I think that this project should take the form of a left-wing populist movement. As I have already suggested, the crisis of representative democracy is not a crisis of representative democracy per se, but a crisis of its current post-democratic incarnation. It is due to a lack of an agonistic debate, consequence of the consensus of the center established between center-right and center-left parties. So what, you know, can be done in order to foster this agonistic debate? Well, I think that what can be done is that it's necessary first to revivify the left-right confrontation. But this cannot consist only in the development of a left party that will be committed to a counter-hegemonic project in order to mobilize democratic forces. It is also vital to establish a synergy between such a party and various progressive civil society movements. So what my argument here is that it's not enough to have a party that will, you know, exclusively a party defend a more radical project. Left-wing populist movement, as I understand it, cannot just consist in a more radical party. And it is very important to establish a synergy between such a party and the civil society movement. So what is at stake is the creation of a collective will thanks to the establishment of a chain of equivalence between a variety of democratic demands existing in our societies. It is clear that the multiplicity of those democratic demands cannot all be expressed through the verticalist party form, because many of these demands emerge through horizontal social movement. And it is not possible nor desirable to try to force those struggles into the verticalist mode. What is needed is a new form of political organization that could articulate the two modes, you know, verticalist and horizontalist. And this is how I envisage the nature of a left-wing populist movement. Well, maybe I am a bit too optimistic, and of course, you know, it's always a bit dangerous to speak about something in which is part specific of a country when you are not from those countries, but To me, it seems that the case of Syriza provides an illustration of this approach of left-wing populism that I'm advocating. Because I think that, you know, you will tell me, I mean, maybe some of you would not agree with that, but I have from what I know from Syriza, I think precisely what we see is articulation between, you know, party and social movement. And also, for instance, what I think is very important is that the aim of Syriza is not clearly not the demise of liberal democratic institutions, but their transformation to make them a vehicle for the expression of popular demand. You know, the fact that they want to come to power is not a stolen strategy of withdrawal from institutions, but the engagement with, you know, arrive to be, you know, state and transform them. So I think that this is clearly the example of the strategy of war of position and engagement with institutions that I advocate. Syriza, of course, is often criticized for being populist. But for me, this is something which is positive, not negative, because populism represents an important dimension of democracy. Indeed, democracy understood as power of the people requires the existence of a demos of a people. And instead of rejecting the term populism, I think we should reclaim it. The agonistic struggle is a struggle about the construction of the people, a struggle between conflicting hegemonic conception of the people, and it is important for the left to grasp the populist dimension of this struggle. Seen in terms of a collective will, the people is always a political construction, and its identity will depend on the chain of equivalence through which it is constructed and the type of adversary to which this people is opposed. As I have repeatedly stressed in my work, there is no we without a they. And what secures a specific chain of equivalence, that is a we, is the they, the adversary to which it is opposed. This is where lies one of the main differences between right-wing and left-wing populism. It is not so much the component of the chain, although this has its importance. But how the adversary is defined. So this is what will determine the identity of the people. Indeed, many of the demands that exist in a society do not have a necessary, an essentialist, reactionary, or progressive character. And it is how they are to be articulated which determine their identity. And this is why the identity of the we depends on the kind of the they to which it is opposed. You know, many of the demands, for instance, in the case of France, is quite interesting to see how Marine Le Pen has been able to articulate a series of demands that come from, you know, well, in fact, she's clearly stealing a lot of steam from the left. She's able to do that because, of course, you know, Hollande and the Socialist Party in power abandoned those demands. So now they are articulated into right-wing populist discourse. And, you know, they are, in fact, quite an important sector of the working class in France vote for Marine Le Pen because she's articulating their demand into a right-wing discourse. But, of course, you know, those demands are not, certainly not essentially right-wing, but there is an attempt of articulating that in another way by Jean-Luc Mélenchon. Unfortunately, at the moment, you know, he's got a real handicap with respect to Marine Le Pen. But those demands, of course, need to be articulated to a left-wing populist discourse. So this is why it's so crucial, the way in which the people is going to be constructed. It's going to be constructed very differently through a right-wing populist discourse and through a left-wing populist discourse. So this point that I've just made, about the different form of articulation, the we of the day, brings to the fore the role that representation plays in the very constitution of a political force. Representation is not a one-way process going from the represented to the representative, because it's the very identity of the represented which is at stake in the process of representation. And this is, by the way, the central flaw of those who argue that representative democracy is an oxymoron and that a real democracy should be direct or presentist. As if democracy could exist without representation, without the constitution of democratic identities. So this is a point in defense of representation against all the exodus anti-representative form. But there is another aspect of left-wing populism that I would like to emphasize. Besides allowing an articulation between different modes of political action, at the party, trade union, social movement, the advantage of left-wing populism is that it acknowledges the central role played by affect and what I call passion in politics. Let me clarify why the difference of all the advocates of what is called the emotive turn. I prefer to speak of passion instead of emotion. I use passion to refer to the common affects which are at play in the collective form of identification which constitute political identities. And I contend that in the process of construction of a collective identity, which is at the core of a left-wing populist project, common affect play a crucial role. The attempt by so many liberal democratic political theorists to eliminate passion from politics and their refusal to accept the crucial role of the affective dimension in politics is no doubt one of the reasons for their hostility to populism. So it is clearly a point there between a certain theoretical approach and a political position. And I think that this is a really serious mistake because, as I have pointed out very often in my work, it is because this terrain is... The success of right-wing populism, the fact that they've been able to make so important inroads in recent years is because the terrain of affect and passion has been abandoned by left parties, because they that's the domain for right-wing populism. You know, we need to speak of argument and all the deliberative theorists insist, no, rational argument, rational argumentation, we don't have anything to do with those, you know, passion. And of course, it means that the terrain is abandoned to the right, and this is why they are able to really, you know, exploit it. Because there is, very rarely is there some kind of attempt to articulate, to mobilize those passions in a left-wing direction. So I think it's really very important here for the development of a genuine, you know, left-wing populism to recognize the importance of those passions. And I think that this is something which a left-wing populist project, the idea of articulation of a chain of equivalence and the definition of the jury, it's absolutely central, this dimension of passion in such a project. Now, a last point to conclude. Examining the cause of the difficulties encountered in our post-democratic representative democracies, I've argued in this lecture that the future of democracy depends on the development of a left-wing populism that could revive interest in politics by mobilizing passion and fomenting an agonistic debate about the availability of an alternative to the current neoliberal order, which is at the origin of the current process of de-democratization. De-democratization is another term that, you know, goes with, it's of course the same objective, you know, post-democracy, de-democratization of what I call the post-political. They refer to different aspects of the same phenomenon. But I would like to insist that the mobilization that I advocate should take place at a European level, because it is impossible to envisage an alternative to neoliberalism at the purely national level. What we really need is a European left-wing populist movement. And it is urgent to bring about an agonistic confrontation about the future of the EU. So I think that, you know, this agonistic debate should not be only, it needs to be at the national level, but we also need an agonistic debate about the kind of Europe that we need. I'm convinced that in the present conjuncture, such a confrontation, such an agonistic debate about Europe is absolutely vital. Many people on the left are beginning to doubt the possibility of constructing within the framework of the EU an alternative to the neoliberal model of globalization. The EU is increasingly perceived as being an intrinsically neoliberal project that cannot be reformed. It seems vain to try transforming its institution, and the only solution that remains is to exit. This is, you know, what left-wing people think. Some left-wing, of course. Such a pessimistic view is no doubt the result of the fact that all attempts to challenge the prevalent neoliberal rules which are dominant in the EU are constantly presented as an expression of anti-European attacks against the very existence of the Union. Without the possibility of making legitimate criticism of the current neoliberal policies of the EU, it is not surprising that a growing number of people are turning to Euroscepticism. They believe that it is the European project itself that is the cause of our current predicament, and they fear that more European integration could only mean a reinforcement of a neoliberal hegemony. Such a position endangers the survival of the European project, and the only way to stop its expansion is by creating the condition for democratic contestation within the European Union at a European level. In my view, what lies at the bottom of the disaffection with the EU is the absence of a project that could foster a strong identification among the citizens of Europe and provide an objective to mobilize their political passion in a democratic direction. The EU is currently composed of consumers, not of citizens. It has been mainly constructed around a common market and has never really created a genuine European common will. No wonder that in times of economic crisis and austerity policies, some people begin to question its utility, forgetting what has been its important achievement in bringing peace to a continent. What is needed is to foster popular allegiance to the EU and the elaboration of a progressive socio-political European project. Such a project should aim at offering an alternative to the neoliberal model that has prevailed in recent decades. This model is now in crisis, but a different one is not yet available. We could say, following Gramsci, that we are witnessing an organic crisis in which the old model cannot continue, but the new one is not yet born. Alas, the center-left cannot take advantage of this situation because it has accepted for too long the idea that there is no alternative to neoliberal globalization. Moreover, in many countries, center-left governments have played an important role in the process of deregulation and privatization, which has contributed to consolidate neoliberal hegemony. And it cannot be denied that the European institutions have their part of responsibility, a great part, unfortunately, in the current crisis. It is a mistake, however, to present this crisis as a crisis of the European project. It is a crisis of the neoliberal incarnation of the European project. And this is why current attempts to solve this crisis by more neoliberal policies cannot succeed. The only way to fight against the rise of anti-European feelings and to stop the growth of right-wing populist parties which excite those feelings is by uniting European citizens around a political project that could give them hope of a different, more democratic future. And here I think, for instance, that the last European election, I think it was important, for instance, that the candidature of Tsipras, because it shows that there was within the European Union, within people who were fighting for a different Europe, that it's possible to fight within Europe for a different Europe. And I think, for instance, that fact that no, there are a certain number of parties of the left, you know, not center-left, but real left, which are now organized in the party of the European left. They are working towards an alternative to neoliberal hegemony. And the fact that, you know, they have decided to launch an offensive at the European level, and the candidature of Tsipras was an expression of that, I find that extremely positive. I think it's a really promising development, because this is what we need at the European level. And the campaign, you know, that took place, of course, there was absolutely no hope that Tsipras will ever win, but it gave a voice to those people who believe the possibility, fighting the possibility for a different Europe. And for instance, I find it quite interesting that in Spain, for instance, Podemos, which is, as you probably know, coming from a part of the Indignado that began to realize that their strategy of, you know, no, we don't want to have anything to do with the institution is not, in fact, it led to the absolute, you know, majority of the Partido Popular in Spain. So part of the those people have organized now in a party called Podemos. They enter, they are in a strategy of engagement with institutions, and they have elected 5 people to the European Parliament, and they were, of course, defending the candidature of Tsipras. So I think that also in Spain, we are beginning to see a movement into that direction. So I think that is definitely something which is a good sign. Establishing at the European level a synergy between left parties and social movement that will make possible the emergence of a collective will aiming of the radical transformation of the current hegemonic order, I think this is something which is absolutely crucial. And the thought that I would like to leave with you is that if the left is not able to mobilize people's hopes and passion towards a more just and equalitarian society, there is a serious risk that right-wing populist parties will succeed in occupying this terrain. And in that case, what expects us is much worse than post-democracy. Thank you.